years ago, I was blessed to come to this wonderful conference and learn different pastors. And one of the pastors that has been a friend of mine and shared our joys and our sorrows together is Pastor Benjamin Jones. Pastor Jones is our ministerial secretary. Pastor Jones also is pastor in the city of Memphis as well. And we're so glad that he can be here with us today. He comes in as a friend. He comes as a part of our family. And he also comes as a conference official to give us some good news. And so I'm going to invite him to come forward this time to share some good news.
Good morning, Longview.
Good morning.
I'm glad to be home again.
Amen.
Look at your faces. Some of you had a very challenging week. It's okay to smile. Amen. I bring you greetings on behalf of the South Central Conference leadership team, Fellow Edmund, our president, Fellow Humphrey, our secretary, Mr. Mosley, our treasurer. Leadership for us sets the pace in any church. And a congregation doesn't go any higher than leadership. Longview is the mother church in Memphis.
Amen.
And I'm thankful over the years how God has blessed Memphis, starting with Longview. It's our desire from the conference office to see this church continue to grow and to build on the foundations of members and pastors who have served us before. I believe that the Lord's coming soon.
Amen.
And if ever we needed the Lord to bless us and have Holy Ghost men and women lead us, it's now. The conference committee's decided that to support the kind of initiatives and aggressive ministry here, that we'd add to this leadership team an associate pastor.
Amen.
It's my joy today to introduce to you the associate pastor that's been chosen. I'm going to ask Pastor Sintai to come forward.
Yeah.
Cliques and the seats of the scornful. Anger them in the cross. Calls them to ride on the high place of the earth. Feed them with the heritage of Jacob. Lift them above vocational and social frustrations and depression. Hide them in the cleft of the rock, Christ Jesus. Bind them when their hearts are broken. Thank them for their kindness and cooperation. Show them the way of salvation. Give them credit that they deserve. Sharpen them intellectually. And model for them a life that's been truly surrendered to the Lord. Minister to them as they pass from this life about the hope and the glorious resurrection. And rejoice with them and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. In the precious name of him who is good and faithful and everlasting, I challenge you to do these things in the name of Christ.
Amen. It's our privilege to say good afternoon, church. Good afternoon, church. In case I'm getting a little bold, I have to use glasses. I hope you don't mind that. Thank you for allowing me to use glasses. Brother Jones, Senior Pastor Alex Hahn, and members of the Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist in Memphis, Tennessee, under the power of the Holy Ghost, as the associate pastor, I pledge myself to support and become a part of the leadership team of this congregation. By the power and grace of God, I will be a servant of God and a spiritual guidance for his congregation. I will model all that is good and in harmony with the scriptures. I will leave above by the grace of God the destruction of the evil one. I will preach every sermon as if it were my last. Pray that God can use me completely. I'll try my best to be cool when things get hard. I'll run, but not too fast for the people. I will try my best to stand when the Lord becomes heavy. I'll try my best to keep a smile when ill winds blow. I will face the difficult moments with spiritual determination and dedication. I will try my best to exhibit meekness, gentleness, and kindness in all that I do. I will minister to you in your homes as well as at the church. I will try my best to lead the church in ministries of growth for the kingdom, congregation, and person. Develop, sponsor, and support ministries that are relevant to the time and that project the mission of our church into the community. I will encourage nurturing ministries for the congregations so that all of our energies are not focused on winning others while we are losing those who are already here. I will walk and not get weary, sing and never get tired. Work so that when the trumpet of the Lord shall sound, and time shall be no more, and the roll is called up yonder, we all shall be there.
Church to move forward is more than just the pastor's commitment. The church family has to make a commitment. On the back of the program, I want you to repeat to me our commitment to these men. Read with me. By the grace of God, as a faithful member of this congregation, I will guard carefully the avenues to my soul. Give sufficient time to daily study of the Word of the Lord. Support unselfishly the ministries of our church with my time and talent. Never leave or pass my God-given Christian responsibility onto others. Willingly, faithfully, liberally, and cheerfully make available to our church the financial resources with which I have been blessed, as the Word of God instructs us. provide a positive Christian model for our youth to follow. Avoid activities that undermine the mission of our church. Continue or become an active soul winner for the spiritual and miracle growth of the kingdom of God in our congregation. Go where God leads me. Enjoy my relationship with the Lord. Order my life that Sabbath-keeping is spiritually uplifting and refreshing. Receive and love and accept our new pastor and perfectly follow the leadership as he follows Christ. From this day forward, I will rejoice and be exceedingly glad. For great is my reward in heaven. These things I have so declared by the power and grace of Christ Jesus, my Savior. I'm going to ask all of my church elders to meet me and Pastor St. Thomas down front, because we want to pray a prayer of dedication.
Get this pastoral joy that bubbles over.
a genuine affection for his people. Give them favor with the people around us. And may, Lord, he actually listen to us and feel our hurts and share our sorrows. And then, Lord, fill him up and preach him out. You promised that we're living in latter rain times, that the greatest expansion of the church since the first century will happen in this last century. Do it here. Do it with this people. Do it with this pastor. Do it with this pastor's team. And when people keep saying, what happened at Longview? What's going on? We can say Jesus is in the house. Jesus is in the pastor's staff. Jesus is in the heart of Pastor Santosh, Pastor Horton. And Lord, as they follow you, we'll follow them. And when you've done all you need to do, please come back and get us. But not us alone. Every man, woman, boy, and girl marked for the salvation season that you plan to take from Memphis. Help us touch them and get them ready. In Jesus' name.
It's always exciting to have people to volunteer and to work together. And it's great to have someone to help share the load. Sometimes the load gets heavy. And I'm so thankful that God has given us a man that loves the Lord. I'd like to welcome you, Pastor Santosh, to this wonderful church. It's a church where we want to reflect Christ. Sometimes we get a little dull, but Christ is still working in us. And I hope that you will stay prayed up. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Everybody else here, we all have some learning disabilities. We all have issues. But there is nothing too hard for God. So I want to welcome you as a part of our team. I'm so glad to be able to communicate and work with one another. And Paul and Silas, that's what we want to work with. That's the kind of relationship we want to have. Church, I wanted to welcome him as a part of our family. Will we all just stand up and just give him a hand and say, welcome. Because you notice that he didn't have a Tennessee accent. Okay, he'll tell you some more about that, but listen close because he's got the word of God. You just got to, it's a tactic so that you have to listen. So he said, what did he say? You got to listen, all right? Good to have you here, man.
We're going to ask the church clerk to come forward to give you a church roll so you know who your people are.
Good morning, Pastor. On behalf of the Longview Heights Church, Longview Heights Seventh-day Adventist Church, I am Karen Jenkins, the head church clerk, and I would like to extend you a loving and warm welcome to our congregation. At this time, I'd like to present a copy of you to the church roll, and I know you will get plenty of use out of this. May God richly bless you as you minister to us here at Longview Heights.
We don't have the keys to the kingdom, but we do have the keys to Longview. Oh, that's my thing with the keys to Longview.
Hey, Pastor. Welcome. With this ring, I demand, but with these keys on this ring, I demand thee to the doors of Longview and
the devil would try to destroy these men. I need you to pray for these men. Build a wall around these men with support and prayer so that when the devil comes at them, he has to come through you to get to him. I want to keep the devil on the outside of the church, so don't bring him in with you. And I'm asking these brothers to live lives in front of you that if you don't understand their theology, you can imitate their living and still be saved. We're living in the most exciting time in the world to be a Christian. I'm running into people every day who years ago would have not even spent 5 minutes talking to me about the Bible because their lives are falling apart at a rate they don't understand. They're coming back saying, does God have a word for me? There's a Hezekiah window around this church. For a short time, between now and the end, men are serious about their spiritual emptiness. And they're hungry to know somebody who not only knows to talk the truth, but lives the truth in front of them. You do that, and this church will be too small. Soon and very soon, the Lord is coming. And I want to be able to say, Longview is ready, Lord. St. Todd's is ready, Lord. Horton is ready, Lord. He who shall come will come and will not tarry. God bless you.
Stand, I'm glad to report that it's there.
ways you can live now. Because where God is, that's where I want to be. Come and talk to me, somebody. The choir said, God is love. And that's who He is. I want to thank God for allowing me the honor and privilege of being here today. Somebody eloquently conveyed to me from a biblical perspective that we've got all things are possible and without God everything becomes impossible. So it behoves us to keep on trusting Him. I want to thank the South Central Conference for allowing me the privilege to come here to serve you to the best of my ability. I want to personally thank Dr. Jones, who is not only my boss and my supervisor, but my friend, my mentor. And many times Dr. Jones would call me, and I would like get a little nervous. I'm like, why is this man calling me? And he's just wanted to chat with me. And I said, Lord, I couldn't need a better friend than a boss. So, Dr. Jones, as I've told you before, I really love you and I thank you for having allowed God to allow you to be in my life. Thank you very much. And my senior pastor, Elder Horton, when I met Elder Horton, I spoke to him for about an hour, and he looked at me straight in my eye, and was just very quiet, looking at me straight in my eye. I said, Lord, this big man is going to be my boss. You've got to talk to this man. And I found out that he is one of the most loving people that I have met. He called me the other day. He said, Greg, it's going to be a woman-sideless relationship. Get on board, son. Get ready for the ride. I want to thank you, Elder Horton, for the way you have treated me so far. And before God and this congregation, I promise you that I will not only be respectful, but I will give you all the support, more support than you anticipate from me. As I've said to you before, I have no expectations of you. All the expectations are on me to cooperate with you to do what God would have us to do. So I have no expectations of you. All the expectations are on me to cooperate. I want to thank my friend Denise, who decided to come and support me. Thank you, man. God bless you. He was my schoolmate, and he said, man, I will be here with you. That's what friends are for. Pastor Matthew, I've known you for a long time. When I pastored up in Canada, we've known each other for a minute. I want to thank the church for opening your arms to allow me the honor and privilege to serve you to the best of my ability. I think the reason why Elder Horton has allowed me to stand here is to preach. Is that all right with you? And so that's what I think that I love to do best, is to win souls for the Lord and preach the everlasting gospel. So I'm going to ask you, in the most humble way that I know how, that you would be kind enough to bow your heads and pray with me and for me as I reminisce through this message. Father God, what you've done with me in the past is not enough. I'm going to ask you, Lord, to renew the power of the Holy Spirit in my life. As I go through this message, would you be kind enough to make this message so clear that even the babies among us may understand? And so when all shall have been said and done, may all the glory and the honor be given to you. But would you be kind enough to give us your blessings? Because we ask it all in Jesus' name, may God's people say, amen and amen. For those of you who like titles, can I have a little power here, please, if someone would allow me that privilege? For those of you who love topics, my subject is entitled, First Come, First Served, No Appointments Necessary. First come, first served. No appointments necessary. Now, I got my two bosses sitting in the congregation. Would you all be kind enough to allow me to come a little closer? I'm a very small guy. Can I come a little closer, please? Thank you. I'm small. You have to tell me I'm a small guy. Can everyone see me? Ladies and gentlemen, would you be kind enough turn your Bibles with me to Mark chapter 5. Which book did I say?
Mark.
Mark chapter 5 and verse 21. Take it from 22 to 26. Would somebody be kind enough and bold enough to stand up and read in God's house, God's word? Mark chapter 5. I'm going to ask my boss. I feel comfortable with my boss to tell him to read for me. I love him. I love him to preach with me when I preach. Elder Jones, would you be kind enough to read? Mark chapter 5, verse 20, 26.
I'm reading out of the New Living Translation. Mark 5, 20 to 26. So the man started off and went to 10 towns. And that region proclaimed the great things that were done for him and every one of them. And Jesus got in the boat and went back to the other side of the lake where a large crowd gathered around him on the shore. And then the leader of the local synagogue, whose name was Gregory, arrived. When he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet, pleading fervently with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and lay your hands on her. Heal her so she can live." So Jesus went with him, and all the people followed him, crowding around him. There's a woman in the crowd had suffered for 12 years with constant bleeding. She had suffered a great deal from many doctors, and over the years she had spent everything she had to pay them. But she had gotten no better. In fact, she had gotten worse. She had heard about Jesus, so she came up behind him through the crowd and had touched his robe. Well, she thought to herself, if I can just touch his robe, I'll be healed. And immediately, the bleeding stopped. And she could feel her body that she had been healed of her terrible condition. Then Jesus realized at once that healing power had gone out from him. So he turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched me?" The disciples said, "And look at this crowd pressing around you. How can you ask who touched me?" But he kept on looking around to see who had done it. And then the frightened woman, trembling in realization of what had happened to her, came and fell to her knees in front of him and told him what she had done. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace."
Amen. Come and say amen, church.
Amen.
Would you be kind enough, ladies and gentlemen, to allow me to commence this message by saying she was a stunningly beautiful, successful, admirable, and popular. She was every man's wish and every woman's nightmare. Men oftentimes crowded and lavish her with attention, gifts, and entertainments. Are you all still with me? Her wardrobe was overlaid with designer clothes and jewelry, with her name and signature printed on every piece. Her financial worth was beyond what words are able to articulate. She, in other words, lived the American dream. Life would have it that one morning, she woke up feeling a little different from the norm. It had been 4 days past since her monthly regularities should have been over. She is concerned, but not worried. What was once a concern quickly became her worst nightmare. Like many of us, ladies and gentlemen, she could not believe what was happening to her. She panicked and rushed to the doctor, hoping it was just a phase and not a malady. Hoping for the best, she visited the best gynecologist, and as most doctors usually do, gave her some encouragement, stating that it might just be a biological change. Take 200 or
city. Days turn into weeks. Weeks turn into months. Yet, there is no sign of change or getting any better. She is the woman with the issue of blood. She could not understand how she was healthy at one time and enjoying life to the fullest, and now sick and depressed at another. How can she be popular, beautiful, and desirable at one time and isolated and lonely and undesirable at another? I too cannot understand how we can be happy at one time and be sad at another.
Check yourselves out.
When I got baptized in the Seventh-day Adventist who left the pants. He was from England, came to visit, but you know the Holy Ghost worked in mysterious ways. Some people say he forgot the pants. I said, no, the Holy Ghost left it there for me. The Lord knows that I had to accept him at one time. And so he forgot the pants. It was a 34. Up to today, I still don't take a 34, I take a 32 by 32. So I went to a friend of mine. I said, can you put a few dabs in this pants for me? To make it seems like it's a 32. I came to the church. Beloved, I tell you one thing about the God that we serve, he's not to be played with. I came to the church, the pastor said to me, it doesn't matter who you are, where you are, what's going on with you, I don't care what's going on with you, just come to Jesus and he'll fix you. I said, Lord, I'm depressed, I'm a nobody, I'm coming to you just as I am, I'm going to trust the preacher, and if the preacher is wrong, I'm going to be pissed off a man. You can trust Jesus for coming through. Are you listening to me? Y'all saw the way I walked around. Well, that's not what I walked. That's not how I walked when I walked in. I said, the Lord said, come as you are. That's how I walk. I'm coming as I am. Ladies and gentlemen, when I came to the church, I saw a lot of beautiful young ladies. But English is not my first language. My first language is Creole. And I speak French as well. And so when they realized that I could not manipulate the English language effectively and adequately, I became a leprosy, a man with leprosy. So everybody wants to say, this guy's not here, that's what we need. Yes, all the young ladies don't want to talk to me no more. You know, I became the guy down the street. Everybody started talking about my father. Now I became this nameless guy. I can identify with this woman. A certain woman. She is nameless, unpopular, and undesirable. Nothing today has changed. I went to a church to preach, and I'm not going to tell you which church. This is none of your business. I went to that church. I got there for Sabbath school. I sat down right there. 5 of us in the class. Until this day, the man who was teaching the class is yet to say hi to me. That's why people don't want to be among us. I said, they are nameless. But I thank God all of us are not like this. Come and talk to me, somebody. I went to a class this morning and the man asked me my name. He said, where are you from? Who are you? And he kept on pressing me and I kept on pressing the issue down. And beloved, let me say this to you. We are not going to be saved because of who we are. We are going to be saved because of who God is. Are you listening to me? The Bible said, a certain woman, oh, that crucified me. The text just before said, Jairus, a ruler of the king of the Jews. He's Jairus, a ruler of the temple. And listen, what crucified me was the fact that the text had the nerve, the audacity, and the temerity to say that he's worthy of what you're supposed to be doing for him. As it were, everybody's not worthy of the love of God. Look at the text. He's worthy that you should go and do this thing for him. But when it comes to the woman, of a certain woman, the Bible said that she had an issue of blood. Her issue of blood not only affected her self-worth, but also made her an outcast of the community and society. I stop by here to tell you why you're still thinking about this woman. I stop by here to tell you that you two have your issues and I have my issues. We've got our issues. She had a biological issue. I will take a biological issue every day as opposed to a spiritual issue. Woman with an issue of blood. Her self-esteem was completely demolished, ladies and gentlemen. And to make matters worse, as I used my sanctified imagination, I realized that the reason why everybody in town knew that this woman had an issue of blood was not because simply because she had an issue of blood, was because of the men who knew she had an issue of blood. Can I talk about as an issue of blood unless she tells them. But remember, in retrospect, she had all these men going up with. She had life going well for her. So when a few guys went up with her, they realized that their desires could not be met. You know how men do it. Nowadays, men, you gotta forgive me, but that's what I'm beginning to realize, that men talk more than women nowadays. So everybody knew her business on the street. Oh man, I was with her last time, man. Should not be going to go there, man. Is this sister, man? She got some issues, dog. You don't want to go there. Everybody knew that the woman had an issue.
All right.
Luke said that she had spent all she had. How do you know she had spent all what she had if you were not her accountant or her doctor? Help me out, somebody. Luke said that she had spent all she had, which is to say that he must have gotten a good portion and had done very little. As a matter of fact, she grew worse. For 12 years, ladies and gentlemen, she went from doctor to doctor, from place to place. Are you all still with me? For 12 years, she attended every healing service and every denomination. I'm still using my sanctified imagination there for a minute. She flew to Atlanta to see Crawford Dollar, went to see Benny Hinn, then went to T.G. Jakes, after which came to the Holiness Church of God, and guess where she ended up? In the Seventh-day Adventist Church that teaches that if you keep the law of God, you keep the Sabbath, you do well, then you can be in favor with God. Can you see her just quietly coming in and the healing service is going on and everybody's falling around and she gets there and the preacher puts his hands on her and she feels a little better for a minute, but as she walks out of the door, the issue of blood continues. Religion will not save. Did you hear me? Religion will not save us. It is our relationship with God that will save us. Religion is the vehicle that transports us to the introduction of salvation. Ladies and gentlemen, but after having tried all, she grew worse. As I said, can I tell you that I didn't talk to her? I sat down in the text and I spoke to the woman. Because unless you put yourself in somebody's shoes, you don't know what they're going through. So I sat down and I spoke to her. Can I share with you what she told me? As I spoke to her, she openly confessed that she wanted me to share her story with you. For 12 years, she had very little friends. Oh, my mama told me something, and I know, let me tell you something. If there is one person I believe apart from God, is my mama. Amen. My mother told me, if you really want to know if somebody is a true friend, get yourself in trouble.
Amen.
The first time you call, they'll answer because they don't know why you call them. And after you explain to them how much trouble that you're in, the next time you call, oh yeah, they're gonna miss that call. So can you imagine with me what the woman is going through? Now women, y'all know how y'all treat each other sometimes. You get jealous of each other. You talk about each other. Can you imagine this one is calling this one? Girl, she thought she was all that. Now look at her. Look at her right now. And you know what is sad, Pastor Harvey? It happens in church. It happens in church, Pastor Harvey. For 12 years, she had very little friends. For 12 years, never had a good night's rest. Some of you are sitting right here, you don't know the last time you heard it from your spouses or your friends. You know what is the worst thing about Christianity? The worst thing about Christianity is not about people doing the law. One guy called me and he said, Pastor, you know, it's a woman who called me and said, Pastor, this man is, I'm having an affair with this man, and he has my phone and he has money for me, and I'm telling him that I want my money. I said, well, if you want your money, don't tell me about your affair with him. Take that to God. Take it to God. The point I'm trying to make here is, ladies and gentlemen, is this. Sometimes when everything goes on fine, then we are nice people. But when it turns bad, then we turn bad too. We do it as a tit-for-tat Christianity. For 12 years, she could not hear the word love. For 12 years, she suffered with pain, shame, and humiliation. Can you imagine? You are a young woman and you can't be among everybody else in spite of whatever is going on? She told me that after 12 years, she finally accepted that her illness was there to stay. But as American people say, it is what it is. Now listen to you all very carefully when I talk. She said, Pastor G, I will have to accept against my wish that what I fear most is what has taken place in my life. What does this mean? What does this mean to this woman? She said, Pastor G, I had to accept that I would never have children. Anybody here can talk to me about this thing? She said, I'll never have a husband. You know, when some women get to be 30, they become nervous. She said, Pastor G, I will never have someone to love and care for me. Never have a family. We'll have to grow old and die alone. Be the outcast of society. Be the orphan no one will care for and accept. I would be no value to my family and my community. People would walk on the other side of the street when they see me coming in the opposite direction. I wish, Pastor G, that I would die because it's better to be dead than to be alive with all this pain, humiliation, and suffering. If you have never been there, then keep on living. There are times in our lifetime things will happen to us, and if we do not have a good grip on our relationship with God, beloved, we shall be consumed with problems. I felt so sorry for the woman because I have 9 sisters and 9 brothers. I have seen my mother go through stuff that I would never call anyone. I made a promise to my mother. I said, woman, let me say this to you. For as long as you live, you can bet your life you said is in church. Listen to me now. When your pastor gets up on you simply because of your shortcomings, what hope do you have? When your husband leaves you for a younger woman and you are now in your not too young age, who can soothe your pain? When your own brothers and sisters ostracize you because you are not equally successful, who else can you trust? When your own mother gives you up for adoption, how much love can you give to society and people?
Jesus is coming to town.
What she said, well, who is this Jesus? She said, but Grandpa, you said you'll be passing through where? That's what good news do for people. Get you home. He said, I'll be passing through where? He'll be passing through Highway 61 there. You're not too far from the junction, from the intersection up there. It's not too far. He'll be coming through your way. You've got nothing to lose by going to see him. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to throw some of the stuff from my sermon. Ladies and gentlemen, all of a sudden, guess what she told me? I'm just telling what she told me. I'm not preaching, I'm just telling what the woman told me. She said, listen, I was young, I was vibrant, and now I'm old, I'm not as strong as I used to, but I'm going to see Jesus. Help me out, somebody. Help me out. I don't have the strength I used to have, but in my island, there is a French terminology. It says, ton belevé. That means when you fall down, somewhere you get the strength to get back up. Help me out, somebody. She said, I'm going to fall down, but I'm going to get back up. Woman, where are you going? I'm going to see Jesus. But historically, let me tell you, historically, it was not right and culturally appropriate for a woman with an issue of blood to be among other people. But she, when I was talking to her, she said to me, Pastor Setanja, and there's nothing that is going to happen to me that has not happened to me. How much more embarrassed can I get? I don't care what people say. I'm going to see Jesus. Oh, Pastor Bayelo, tell you, you woke up this morning and you said, I don't care when I don't have a brand new suit, but I'm going to church. Come and help me out. I'm going to church. I don't care, my relationship is not the best, but I am going to church. The woman told me, Pastor, the embarrassment is nothing compared to what I've been through. I'm going to see Jesus. What the crowd may be fake, I'll find a way around it. I'm going to see Jesus. I said, woman, I've never seen somebody with the tenacity you have. Keep on going. She said, I may never get, listen to what she kept on saying to me, I may never get to meet him because of the press, but it's better for me to try than to stay home. Come and help me out, somebody. Oh, he may never make the time for people of my condition, but I will feel better trying than trying to stay home. Are you listening to me? Ladies and gentlemen, the Bible said, I didn't say it, your ministerial director said, he said that the woman came from behind, but let me fix it for you. I want you to understand, the woman, her issue has weighed her down, and she's at the point where she's not strong like everybody. If you want to kill somebody, drain blood out of them. Are you listening to me? Imagine for 12 years, she's been like this. Everybody wants to see Jesus. You know, there are many people who come to church for various reasons. And Jesus, imagine him coming to town and everybody wants to see him. So here's my I looked at the text and I talked to her and she told me there were people there who were educated people and rich people who just wanted an autograph from Jesus. There are those who just want to invite him to their homes so they can have the most important person in their homes. There are those who just came here because they realized that if they can tell somebody that they met Jesus today, they'll feel important. But I stop by here to tell you that there are those who have more needs than just seeing Jesus. She was one of them. Don't you dare forget that the Bible said that Jairus came to Jesus, and Jesus is on his way to Jairus' house, not to the woman's house. But the Bible said she came from behind. Can I tell you how she came? She came, the press is there. Everybody knows who she is. They curled their nose at her, push her on the other side. But I'm pressing on the other way. Your eyes are good. In every day, I need you to know She was so humble. She says, I know who I am, and I know my place. I'm just going to go from behind him. Some of us need to stop being so arrogant. We think we own the church. We think we own the pastor. We think we can tell him how to do his job. Because, oh, we have a little education. We stand up neck and neck with the pastor and tell him, where did you come from when we were building this church? But let me tell you, we need to learn a thing or two from this woman. She says, I'm not worthy to face him face to face. I will go from behind him. And as she went from behind him, oh, ladies and gentlemen, the Bible said she touched the hem of his garment. Oh, and the judge is going to like this. Ellen G. White said she did not touch the hem of the garment. She touched the border of the hem.
Yeah.
sudden, I feel different. I feel different. And then Jesus stood up and said, who touched me? She said, Pastor, I'm praying like I've never prayed before. I was healed. I didn't cross a few things here. My subject is entitled First Come, First Serve. No appointments necessary. I'm about to bring good news to you. Jairus, we are told, was the first person who went to Jesus. I'm asking, would you come to my daughter's house? She's sick, I need to heal her. Pastor said, how is it that your sermon is entitled First Come, First Serve, when Jairus was there before her? Oh, I got news for you. I don't know, oh, Lord, help me, Father. Oh, I love it, I love it, I love it, how the Holy Ghost showed me what happened. The Holy Ghost told me to tell you that Jairus physically was first in line. That the woman had been first online because she's been praying for 12 years. She had been praying in a house for 12 years. She had 12 years of sleepless nights. She had 12 years of experience going from church to church. She had 12 years of prayer on the line. Pastor, somebody told me, Pastor Horton, that Jesus is on the main line. He can call him up. Call him at midnight, he is awake. Call him at 4 in the morning, he is waiting. Call him at 5, he is listening. The woman had been praying for 12 years. Jairus came the same day, but the woman had 12 years experience before. First time, help me out somebody. My God doesn't care who you are. He said, I saw you praying 12 years before. I'm not going to go heal her before I heal you. Because you've been first in line. I stop by here to tell you, church, that if you have something going on in your life, like I have in my life, keep on praying. My God is no respect of persons. First time, first serve, no appointments necessary. I don't know about you, ladies and gentlemen, but when I went to, when I was in New York City, I've got a cousin of mine. She's a politician, powerful woman. I went to the bank, and the teller just come over. She bypassed everybody, walk up straight to the teller, and I put my hands. I said, "Wow, membership has its privileges." Well, I stop by here to tell you, if God, He does not care about membership has its privileges. If you politician. You don't have to have master degrees. You don't have to have all of these accolades. All what you and I got to do is to come at the foot of the cross. First come, first serve, no appointments necessary. Let me deal with the last battle with the Lord. You know when you go to the doctor, you have to make an appointment, right? Doctor Jesus, come help me out somebody. Doctor Jesus. The woman only heard that Jesus was coming to town. There was no appointment. It's not necessary to make an appointment with Jesus. All what you can do is say, Lord, here I am, take me. Yes. Is there somebody here who wants to say, Pastor? Pastor. I thought I had to make an appointment. But now I don't need to have an appointment. I just look up just as I am. First come, first serve. No appointments necessary. There is someone here who has an issue. You've been having this issue for a long time. Now I'm going to do it right. You've been having this issue for a long time. Put my fingers. One is pointed at you and I have four pointed back at me. So we all have issues. Let's get that straight. But there's somebody that wants to say, Pastor, I need you to pray for me. Yeah. I'm not saying pray for me, pray with me. Uh-huh. Pastor, we won't have issues, but I just need you to pray with me, Pastor. I need to stand where you are. Stand wherever you are. God bless you. Come in together. Come meet us here. Come meet us here. Anyone who's not coming, we all have issues, church. Come, let's pray. If God, if Jesus could do it for this woman, he can do it for us, church. Are you listening to me? Some of us, let me tell you, our issues is that we have become cold. We become cold. The fire that we once had for the Lord, we don't have it anymore. And it's about time that we say, Lord, please take me as I am. I've got an issue. Help me out. Somebody needs to come at the foot of the cross. There's no excuse for us not making it. The woman came. She said, Lord, I am tired of people talking about me. I'm tired of going through this thing. I am tired. Somebody is tired of going through some problems. You're tired. You're tired. You're sick and tired of being sick and tired. It's time to say, Lord, the same way you stood still for this woman, you can stand still for me. Somebody has to stand up. I'm going to make it through. I am going to make it through. Do we have any visitors here? People who are just visiting this church today. You are a visitor. You're not a member. Raise your hands if you're not a member. You, Kevin Jones, will you please go close to this young man who's standing there? If you're a member, not a member. You're a visitor. All visitors, raise your hands for me. If you are a visitor, raise your hands. If you're visiting, raise your hands. Excuse me, please. If you are a visitor, raise your hands. Come close to this young man. We'll pray for you. Come, just stand right next to the hands of your man. Anybody else, you are just visiting, we'll pray for you. If you are a visitor, we give our visitors special treatment here. Yes, you can get the special treatment. Is there another visitor? Somebody just visited with us. We want to pray for you. God bless you. God bless you. Church members, let me say this to you. We don't have too much time on this earth. And we all have issues. I'm going to ask God to forgive me if I did not make this message as clear as he wanted me to. But I need you to understand that God is no respecter of persons. All what God cares about is that in spite of whatever is going on in our lives, we are willing to come. And he said, I'll stand still only for you. I'm not moving. I'll stand still only for you until the issue is resolved. Those of you who are standing, would you be kind enough to join us here? Would you be kind enough, those of you who stand, be kind enough to join us here? Thank you very much for your kindness. Thank you very much for your kindness. And those of you who are seated, would you be kind enough to stand up as we go to close in prayer? And if you feel impressed to come, then we're still waiting. Elder Hubbard, would you be kind enough to pray for us? I'm going to ask the pastor of the church to pray that God, Elder Hubbard, would pray that God would help us in this church to put all of our issues aside and allow God to create a change in our hearts. Would you do that for us, please, Pastor? Elder Jones, I would like for you to pray for the visitors. And I'll have the last prayer.
I'm going to ask those who are near the visitors to leave their hand down with that prayer. We recognize again, Lord, you're the same God today that you were when that woman came by. But only, Lord, that you not move forward. Lord, we know you moved to the side of the crowd where she was ashamed to you. Sometimes, Lord, life is so heavy on us, we don't know what to do. We've been struggling with things, Lord, for a long time, and we're deciding today enough's enough. We've done everything we thought we could do, we didn't fix it. Just like she had, Lord, physical challenges. We have spiritual issues,
yes.
Relational issues, family issues. You said, come to me just like
this.
Pray, Lord, He wants his family members healed. He wants them whole again.
Yes, Lord.
He wants you, Lord, to bring them back to each other, to you. To break their addictions and other issues. To bring peace and wholeness once back to his house. It might be difficult for us, Lord, but we know there's nothing impossible. Around this altar this morning, Lord, we stand each with specific needs. You told the woman if she could believe it, she could do it. You didn't carry medicine in your garment. It was
medicine.
If she trusted you, you would do for her the impossible. Lord, we trust you today. We give you our hurts. We give you our confusion. We give you our anguish. We give you our anger. We give you our depression. We give you our anxiety. We give you our worry. Lord, take it.
Yes.
Exchange your wholeness with our brokenness.
Yes, Lord.
Give us your peace for our chaos. Do whatever you need to do now.
Yes.
To save us.
Amen.
Look into our hearts and our minds, and that which has chained us and held us up and the wall around us and brought a difference between us and God, take it away.
Yes.
Even though we don't feel different, Lord, we're going to claim it. We're going to walk out of here, Lord, with our heads up, knowing that God has done what he said he'd do.
Amen.
And Lord, over the next few days, as we move forward by grace, moment by moment, day by day, you just keep working.
Yes.
And cleaning and fixing and holding. And when you finish with us, come get us. Lord, I love this prayer for these around the altar. You need to do something on everybody in this house. We are tired, Lord, of being almost what we should be. We're tired of hearing people talk about power, but we're not experiencing. Talk about miracles, and we don't have one. Talk about healing, and we're still hurting. Talk about peace, and we're still angry. Lord, put it into our fears and our struggles. For you have said that we have Jesus, we have life. So you be that life for my people. And those who come forward. Now, Lord, the devil doesn't like it when we get close to you. And he's not going to stop throwing rocks because we're here tomorrow. But greater is he who is with us than he who is against us. And we give you permission to do whatever you need to do to have us be at peace when you come. And we claim it. And we thank you for the word and hope today. And for the preacher and his message. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, it's Jesus. Yes, it is Jesus. It is Jesus.
I tried my best, oh God. I pray, oh Father, that you would please help us to realize it's about time that we all press forward to touch the hem of your garment. Help us to stop thinking about how people think about us. Because people have more issues than we have. We have more issues than other people have. So why be bothered about what people think? The time has come when we need to put aside all our differences and have one objective, one goal, and one aspiration, and that is we are going to see Jesus. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy. And we thank you, oh God, that you have showed me that the only way that I will make it through is to come to the realization that I have issues. The same way that you did the woman, I'm asking you to please do. Lord, I'm trying my best to get as close as I can, but every time I get closer, it seems like you're moving. Please stand still, Lord, so that I can touch the hem of your garment and go back to tell my friends and family I've had an encounter with you and I'm not the same anymore. Do this for every single one of us here. And oh God, when the last sermon shall have been preached, when the last prayer shall have been uttered, and the last person shall have made the decision for or against, be kind enough to save us because we cannot save ourselves. Hence the reason why we pray in Jesus' name, may God speak and say, amen.
Amen. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
Come on, say praise the Lord.
Praise
amen. Amen. What a mighty word. I want to touch the hem of his garment. Something happens when you touch the hem of his garment. Something happens. It changes who you are.